So our next speaker is Arkady Dobkin. He's the CEO and co-founder of EPAM. Now, EPAM is one of the world's leading software development outsourcing services companies. It is publicly traded on the New York Stock Exchange. I just checked. It's a nearly $2 billion cap company. He was, in 2008, he was named as Ernst & Young's Entrepreneur of the Year, or one of them. He's won numerous other awards. His career spans US, Belarus, Ukraine. He holds master's degree in electrical engineering from Belarusian National Technical University. And he will tell us a little bit about how EPAM helps product development in a digital age. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. So I just was listening several presentations before and really feel uncomfortable. It was people who understand technology or people who already understand what is venture capitalist, and I'm kind of in the middle, I guess. Okay, I will be talking about product development in digital age from services standpoint. And mostly probably we'll be talking about what I know the best, the story of EPAM. And probably it would be entertaining enough. Okay, so this is a very small slide, but I think it's important. And I don't know how much you know about EPAM. I'll give you a very short update. But it's important slide, and it's from the Geoffrey Moore classic book dealing with Darwin or what companies should do to innovate and how they need to change all the time. And it's very much in line with what Alex Galitsky was talking about. It starts small from the problem and then trying to solve it. But if you don't want just to sell your child in 1 year, but would like to build it, then you have to change it all the time. So what you might know about EPAM, I don't know how much, but I'll give you very short. This is a couple slides from our investment presentation. So this is public information. So company was founded in 93 in Princeton, New Jersey. So simultaneously we open office in Minsk, Belarus, and then spread across former Soviet Union and Eastern Europe. So today we focus on five verticals, actually. One was added recently. Historically, we focus on ISV, and we're helping to build products, but then expanded in a couple others. All these names, which you can see, it's our large clients, which we're serving from 5 to 10 years long term. So we started as a practically classical offshoring company, outsourcing company, like people using it here. When 20 years ago, when Indian industry also only started, we clearly cannot compete with all investments which went to India at this point from General Electric or British Petroleum or any other big companies which were put in dedicated lines. We started very small, but that was the market. And when I was reading 20 years ago Gartner's prediction about this market growing to 10 billion or 40 billion, it seems like unbelievable, but that's what happened. And still EPAM overperformed this market. We, for the last 6-7 years, we're growing probably over 35% per year. And last 2 quarters, we were growing over 30%. So also from the point of view, why we are here, because we clearly relate to Eastern Europe, and we have in Ukraine over 3,000 people. We have offices in Kyiv, Lviv, Kharkov, Dnipropetrovsk, and Vinnytsia. So we're probably largest software engineering employer in the region. So as I mentioned, when we started, Indian industry, we're developing on the assumption that it's much cheaper and value wasn't in the focus. In the focus was simple work which you can do over there to make sure that the serious work would be done in New York, London, or San Francisco. It was practically impossible for us to start the same way because relationship between or kind of relationship to former Soviet Union was probably in line with what there is today between US and Russia. So the only opportunity to kind of attract attention was actually to find this differentiation point, technology or some specific knowledge which would attract companies. And we find something like this, and I'll tell you very quickly the story how we started. Like when we'd been just 20 people, by accident, we got an opportunity to build warehouse management system for large European retailer for all North American operation. Company called Bali of Switzerland, you probably know it. Then we built Salesforce automation for them, and then we started to do the same for Colgate Palmolive. And then it was 96 when Siebel was a startup. One of the top people at SAP saw this application and told about it to Hasse Plattner, who is the founder of SAP. And we've been invited to demonstrate this application in 96. Salesforce automation for Colgate Palmolive. And on spot, we were hurried to build prototype for Sapphire to show a new line of business. And then our team was hurried to build the first architecture for Salesforce automation. And SAP became a client. We started to learn from them how to build products professionally. And then kind of it was repeated. It became a pattern. We started to work for other software companies. We went through .com, implementing e-commerce solutions, competing at this point with Amazon and ATG and Priceline, other kind of very famous companies today. And implemented it globally from States to Japan to Europe. So when we've been 200 people, we accumulated pretty strong product development expertise. From this slide, you can see some other clients from ISV and technology, which working with us for many, many years, and how organically we built very specific competencies over the years. What happened then, that these companies in technology were kind of split in three different categories. It was platform companies, because we were doing tens of millions of dollars with SAP and Oracles and Googles. Or it was startups in specific areas, like doing booking engines for travel industry or financial configuration engines or third category, it was kind of emerging technologies from mobility to BI, later big data and so on. So, and by developing this competencies in very hands-on fashion, because we were doing this for the clients, but then we were helping to implement this technology for their clients. We're starting to understand the industry, and what we find ourselves that our share from working in what it called then outsourced product development space starting quickly decreasing, and the number of solutioning for specific industries starting to increase. We kind of originally thought that it's a normal process and maybe even kind of happening by accident that we come into these specific industries. But then we realized that there is actually market transformation. And if you look to the amount of work coming for global delivery, which was predicted like 5 years ago that it would be around 40 billion. There is subset of this, which is 14 billion market, which is more sophisticated, more quality demanding product development subset. And that's where we play. And this market, even in the past, was growing 2 times faster than general IT global delivery market. You all know, and today people talked about it, how digital influencing all these industries. These industries, number of them, which is like 10 years ago, didn't think that they need technology. Today becoming practically software companies. Insurance industry completely changed by technology. Banking and financial services clearly changed by technology. Media, entertainment, publishing all converted. So completely different business models, completely different requirements, and close to 100% dependency on technology. So, and this is covering practically all industries today. In result, what we were starting from, which people were calling outsourced product development, started to be split now between professional software companies, and also people were talking today about it, for the companies which know that they depend on the software and they have to build the new type of solution with sophistication and complexity and usability to be competing with Amazons and Googles and Facebooks because all these companies come into their markets. But at the same time, these companies have a problem because they never been a technology world. They don't know how to build products. And that's exactly the opportunity which I think help us to grow. So there is growing number of companies which has to build new type of solutions. And most of them don't know how to do it. And when they come into traditional IT vendors, big one and small ones, sometimes these companies that doesn't have understanding as well, don't have understanding as well how to build this new type of applications with usability, quality, which would be competing with Facebook, which would be competing with Amazon's or eBay, because that's how they're supposed to survive. This is a slide from Gartner, how they look to traditional IT service provider today. And they say, okay, today, 70% of revenue for these service providers coming from operations. If you look at the any large IT provider like Wipro, Infosys, or even Cognizant, they will have 70% or so coming from support and maintenance. Design and build, relatively small number. What Gartner saying, this is all would be changed because there is demand for new systems. And in 2020, it would be kind of completely different split. This is just another slide to illustrate the same point. And when we're talking about opportunity with this new product development in digital world, it's very interesting that in case of us, in case of EPAM, we're already there because we build the company of helping software companies to build products. We know how to do it in right quality, in right process, and we have an opportunity actually to capitalize on this market, which Forrester estimating right now will be growing much faster than offshoring or outsourcing market, which was born 30 years ago. So they predict that by 2018, it would be almost 50 billion market, which is today is under 10. The challenge for vendors to address it, it's pretty strong. It's a necessity to have very specific set of capabilities. Because these systems which should be built require very coordinated, harmonized level of effort. And also the difference between historically what IT industry was built up during the last 30 years, which is system of records where people were counting money, putting ERP system, even if you think like CRM, it's still internal process. CRM used by internal salespeople. It's optimization versus system of engagements, which is actually allowing clients to increase their revenue. Completely different set of capabilities, completely different set of split of skills. User experience becoming extremely important, data becoming extremely important, infrastructure becoming much less important. Again, talked about it. Very unique set of skills. Like, I'm not going to read through the slide, but you already discussed it today because like from the very beginning, people were presenting what is Internet of Things, how it could be integrated to e-commerce, how mobility, big data, all this analytics important. And there is not too many companies which have the right set of skills to do big programs. And that's an opportunity, and that's a demand for product development in this age. And all this, all life cycle should be supported on daily or hourly releases. Agility becoming critical. This is not just technology. Again, people discuss it today. It's an integrated process and integrated skills. And the gap analysis. This is what have to be inside of this new type of vendors for this market. It should understand how to change revenue of the client, should understand how respond with the speed, get product to market, support product on the market, free up time and money for the next wave of the investment, because all these investments right now is very short living. That's why traditional product companies are actually having a lot of troubles, because by the time that they generalize enough, the technology running away, and you need to practically rebuild it. That's why actually EPAM is growing. That's why actually a lot of other services solution companies growing, because at the end of the day, clients need solution of their problems, not a package to pay licenses upfront or even on subscription basis. So, and the know-how, this is what we learned when we were helping to build products. The gap is very important, and that's what we need kind of to build in EPAM and probably in many other services companies if they would like to stay relevant. So industry knowledge, user experience, change management, real product management, because this is, again, was a question I was listening before. Somebody asked, services company, who is defining products? In the past, definitely clients, because clients were professional software product companies. Clearly, SAP not allow us to define product, even if we were playing extremely visible role in designing this. But what's happening when your client's a retail company or financial company, which don't have time even think about it, that's different. You need to provide these capabilities as well. So legacy, again, extremely important, because legacy system should be changed, or special APIs built up, because they need to work differently or be replaced. Continuous integration, DevOps, again, talked about it as well. So what we're doing today to satisfy this requirement, how EPAM bridging the gap? So we invest in thousands of man years in internal platforms, productivity platforms, to make sure that people in different locations with different set of skills from different groups can work together very, very effectively. So we're investing in a lot of accelerators. We're investing in EPAM Cloud, in EPAM App Store, InfoEngine, and I can talk and talk about it, but again, I probably cannot bring too much depth, so I'm just giving the point. And it is thousand man years. So what we're doing also, we investing in industry expertise through very small acquisitions or from specific dedication of funds to build competency centers. We built competency centers for financial services in 2009 when we had zero revenue from capital markets. Today it's over 200 million business for us. So we invested to build competency center in media in 2009. Today it's 10% of our business. So we did acquisition of healthcare company because we do believe that health care and health insurance would be very strong driver for our growth during the next years. Just recently, we did acquisition for life sciences company, and this is really core expertise. It's people with hundreds of people with degree in medical science and chemistry and bioinformatics, and they're working for R&D department of 5 out of 8 largest life science companies. With our software product expertise together, we probably will benefit them and ourselves very strongly. And we continue to work with software companies. We still have today 100 software and technology companies as our clients. We're learning from them, and we're actually teaching them as well. On top of this, we're building digital strategy and experience design group at EPAM. We're investing in competency centers. We have very strong data science group and big data group, cloud group, enterprise mobility group, solution practices horizontal and vertical, EPAM cloud, EPAM apps, that's all we're doing. And on top of this, we have to continue build business consulting organization, agile transformation on the level when we can work with clients very convincingly and we actually can educate them. Industry focus, it's never would be achieved. So IP, all that. So it's a lot of work happening in EPAM with 11,000 people today. So some results just to illustrate that actually all these investments and our focus bringing some results. I'll give you like two short stories. Commerce story. This is a slide which explaining exactly how we were getting to this. We were working with software product companies. We had hundreds of engineers helping to build core enterprise platforms. And then clearly we get exposure. That's it. 5 minutes. Yeah. Okay. Through this experience, we actually started to open direct clients. One of the examples here, Canadian Tire Corporation. That's an example where we've been able to put right on-site presence, right consultative presence, right competency centers, and in 3 years we built business for ourselves, which is in tens of millions of dollars. But we cover it and help to solve them exactly the problem which they're facing externally. We build the enterprise digital marketing platform, the e-commerce platform, solve their backend SAP problems, teach them agile, monitor store performance, analyze big data, bring in data scientists there, traditional business intelligence, executed end-to-end digital strategy, and got very public reference from them. So it's a big business for us. Just Canadian Tire Corporation, largest retail company in Canada with around 500 stores. So another result on data. Again, the same base. We were helping to build Brio software and Hyperion and then many other platforms, build very strong skills there, and then started to apply it outside. Just recently we decided to participate just as an example in a very large RFP run by Security Exchange Committee called Consolidated Audit Trial. Just to understand, all the system developed by special SEC rule to kind of prevent from the future failures like happened in 2008-2009. This is 21 petabytes of securities transaction data. This is probably second largest data warehouse in the world after National Security Agency. 50 billion records should be processed there. So 3,000 financial companies supposed to use this system. We didn't win it. For us, it was a test. But Google participated, IBM participated, Infosys participated, several government agencies participated, which also supposed to do a selection of final vendor. So 31 candidates was there. We presented architecture, presented our data science, capital markets, data warehousing, ETL, all this expertise, and we actually become one of the 6 finals ahead of Google and IBM. So most likely we're not going to win it, but this is already deals in hundreds of millions of dollars. So where is EPAM today? 11,000 engineers. This year we will be over 700 million in revenue. Split by industries, strong financial position. We've been named number two on the Forbes list of America 20 fastest growing technology stars, which is companies, public companies under $1 billion. We've been named number six on the list of 25 fastest growing technology companies in America. Forrester ran the first wave for product development services and put us as a leader in this space. So everything is great, seems like. Unfortunately, as soon as you forget about that, everything could be finished very, very quickly. So, and competition, all of us, for a long time we were considering ourselves a very small company, and we still consider it because now we're competing with Accenture and IBM of the world. So now we still seems like only the beginning. Thank you very much.